talk shoes. Recorded live.
Hello everybody, this is Jörg once again from YouTube channel Juggler66, and I welcome you all to a new broadcast on Hour of the Truth on Thursday, the 25th of June, 2015. I have been very busy the latest days producing videos and putting them in a waiting row to be uploaded. I follow the reading from Tom Press at this moment on Inquisition Update on the book The Global Vatican from Francis Rooney, who is a former U.S. ambassador to the Vatican. So there we can really have some inside knowledge from that book that Tom is reading on Inquisition Update. And I will upload these videos also later on my two YouTube channels. For the moment, I have 6 videos made already. In the meantime, I was watching a documentary I want to tell you all about. This is in 5 parts, about 15, 16 hours long. I'm in the 3rd part in almost 3 hours now. It is called Prophecy Countdown, the Jesuit Agenda for the SDA Conference Church. And this is very interesting, especially when you put the SDA for a moment aside and see it from the viewpoint of all Protestant denominations. That is exactly what they do. This Pastor John Osborne, who is doing the interview with Bob Trapps and some others in this documentary, is shown book after book after book after book on how the Jesuits infiltrated the SDA, how they use spiritual exercises, how they use neuro-linguistic programming and all that stuff, and how they fulfill everything that so-called the prophetess Ellen G. White spoke about in her book, The Great Controversy. The point being is I am not an SDA, I never was, I never will be. But the point is, after almost 7 hours in this documentary, this pastor John Osborne has one thing that he doesn't understand or haven't understood yet, that the Church of Seventh-day Adventists was founded by Freemasons. And of course it is easy for the Jesuits to infiltrate an organization that they themselves found, because Freemasonry is nothing else than the Protestant arm of the Jesuits. And when you know this and watch this documentary, you can learn a lot about how the Jesuits infiltrate. I mean, these books Bob Treffs puts out there, they are very, very interesting. And there is, among others, one interesting article he puts out from Time magazine. And that reminded me of the time when I was reading Rulers of Evil, Part 1, Subliminal Rome, because that dealt with the Holy Alliance that Ronald Reagan had with Pope John Paul II. And they even analyzed the Holy Alliance in this and how this all works into the Jesuit takeover again. And they speak even about the connections from the Jesuits to the New Age, something Walt and I were discussing a few days ago, I think. I think that was on Sunday on our broadcast when we were there, Walt, when we were discussing about this UN plan they have, that we were dividing a little bit into the New Age, or whatever broadcast it was, one of these last broadcasts we did. We went into the New Age anyway, and this also comes back in this documentary. So when you're interested in this, I will put, of course, a picture of the of the video I'm watching in the video, and probably put the link down there. But if you want to look for this right now, this is called Prophecy Countdown, the Jesuit Agenda for the SDA Conference Church. And when you just type that in Google, in YouTube, in the search engine, you will probably find that. And otherwise, it is uploaded from the channel FTSN. FTSN. So when you go to his channel, you could also probably see that. And yeah, as I said, I already watched 7 hours and still have some 6 hours or something like to go in the future to see. And I think this is very interesting, and I want to advise everybody to have a look at that. And you don't have to be an SDA to understand how the Jesuits work. This is very well explained in this video. Okay, I've been talking enough about this. I know that Walt's heart is full of things that he wants to share with us, and I'm glad he is here to do that. And after he is done, we will continue the reading on the Global Jesuit Vatican Conspiracy and the book from Dr. Ronald Cook from 1985. We will continue on page 27, but first of all, Walt, Welcome to the broadcast, brother. How you doing over there in Romerica? Are you holding up?
We got sunny shores here and sunny skies, and we're looking for a heat wave here.
Oh, we have a very hot day today also. Yeah, about 28 degrees centigrade here.
And we're having a real dry spell. Here, this is the driest. I've been gardening here at the same location for about the last 10 years, and it is so dry that I'm not going to have a full garden of my flowers this year, because I'm just going to hand pick the ones I'm going to feed with water.
Yeah, you're not so far away from dry California, are you?
No. And yesterday, it was kind of the funny skies. I don't like to get into this, but I got to mention the contrails.
And harp, Walt.
Yes, I've seen contrails here on the Oregon coast, but a lot of times I don't have the observation because a lot of times we're overcast. But yesterday, I even seen almost crisscrossing, and it was kind of a white out. In other words, it wasn't like right now we have blue skies here, but yesterday it was a white out, you know. And you know, something I've really been blessed, because the people that do listen to the Hour of the Truth are most all of them are researchers, but prepare yourself and talk to somebody that doesn't know some of the information you do, because I know some of the information doesn't make me more intelligent. It has nothing to do with that, and so where I'm going with that is, I've had some real good emails, and I've had a chance to talk to about three brothers, and younger men in their 30s. See, and man, when I was their age, this whole world was not they hadn't hit us as quite as hard. But these young men that I've been talking with have their eyes wide awake. They're wide awake. They're just and I've learned so much about them. And then this last week I had a call from a former police officer. And you know, we have to look at history like we're investigating a crime. See, what always covers up a crime is the information is that's omitted. See. And you know, I want to start with this. Everybody has heard, if anybody has went to my website, granddesignexposed.com, and heard me talk, you know, you always talk, I talk about the Jesuits, but I talk about the Carrolls. Charles Carroll, John Carroll, and Daniel Carroll. Now, and also, it came to me this last couple of weeks, you know, I've been thinking on this, and it really hit me yesterday. Now, most everybody in here has heard Chris Pinto, The Hidden Faith of the Founding Fathers. The Hidden Faith of the Founding Fathers. One thing, and there's one whole segment in there that Chris he breaks his documentation up, one on Jefferson, one on Thomas Paine, and then one on George Washington. And in one whole segment, he has Washington and the Jesuit connection. Now, you know, stop and think of his title of his, The Hidden Faith of the Founding Fathers. Now, through that whole documentation, you know, he will use the word universalism and Freemasonry and such, but here's where the Carroll connection comes in, see? On his documentation, he mentions the Carrolls, but nothing against the documentation, because when a man's putting something like this together, he's got so much to pick from. And so he mentions the Carrolls, but you see, he should have had a whole segment on the hidden founders, the three hidden founders. Because you see, the hidden faith of the founding fathers is universalism. And it's right out there. If you're going to hide a tree, hide it in the forest. Now, it's right in the documentation, but he doesn't come out and say it. Universalism, another word for universalism, is Romanism, is Catholicism. It's universal. And we see this really coming to fruition now with the visit of the Pope here in September. So you see, and from I just came across this just a couple days ago. I had a friend of mine, we were talking back and forth on Skype, and he texted this to me. He said, all ministers of our out of today, seminaries are nothing more than Roman Catholic priests in theology, and therefore, by extension, are counter-reformation. That is not stop. Because, you know, sometimes you've heard me talk for about 5 or 6 months. I didn't make any kind of broadcast because I kept saying to myself, I said, well, Walt, are the carols that important? Who cares about the carols? Well, you see, if you're investigating a crime, you can't omit the evidence. See, and the carols are very important. And the Jesuits, they founded the Jesuits in 1789, same year we officially became a country, Georgetown University. Now, let's reread what my friend said in a text. He says, all ministers out of today's seminaries are nothing more than Roman Catholic priests in theology, and therefore, by extension, are counter-reformation. I'm going to go a little bit further here. I have a man that I listen to on a blog talk, and I had a chance to talk to him. And if he's listening, he'll understand who I'm talking about. But the name isn't important. The name is not important because it was through him that I woke up. Because he told me one day, he said, you know, Walt, he said, I went to Bible college. And, you know, they taught us a little bit about the Reformation. But they taught us nothing about the Counter-Reformation. Now, he went out and practiced and was a minister for over 30 years. And he didn't realize that it isn't what he was teaching, he wasn't teaching. Now we can't blame the man, because you see, every single seminary and Bible college have been overtaken. That is the reason why we can have the historical, biblical, and prophetic man of sin, the son of perdition, come to speak on September 23rd. It's because they've infiltrated not only every seminary, but now let me take you, I'm trying to paint a picture here that's come to me the last couple of days. But when I was out in the truck from 1991 to 2001, I read a book called The Dark Side of Freemasonry by Ed Decker. I even got a copy in my computer. I mean, it's a long story, but I got a copy of me reading that on tape, and I used to pass it out when I was driving truck. In the chapter, I found it this morning on the internet. It's up on Ed Decker's website, but it's called The Public School Connection by Tom McKinney. Now, when I read that back in probably 1996, 1997, I was reading everything I could about Freemasonry. And if you remember our last broadcast, we were talking about the New Age. Now, let me bring this up before I discuss a little bit about the public school connection. By the way, this is up on the internet. I found it. I knew it was in, and everybody in here, I mean, I'm pretty sure that most people, not maybe not everybody is going to know it. But you see, up until 1990, the Masonic magazine, their main journal magazine, was called the New Age Magazine. See, and it wasn't until 1990 they were getting a lot of heat because there was a lot of books out there exposing the New Age. So they changed the title to the Scottish Rite Journal. Now, how does this fit in with the public school connection? Why do we see so much New Age? This is the swallowing up. Now, this public school connection, like I said, I read this entirety and had it recorded, and I read it in the back seat of a truck in about 1996. You know, it's why are Freemasonry, the New Age, and the Mormonism so determined to promote public schools while resisting Christian schools, private academics, and homeschooling? I just want to read this a little bit of this article. I'm not going to read the whole thing, but he says, now this is Tom McKinney. Now Tom McKinney, he wrote this, but it's in the second chapter of The Dark Side of Freemasonry. And he calls it the Masonic Commitment. And my earliest studies of Freemasonry, I noticed a curious thing. One of its principal public policies is to promote and defend the public school system. Not just schools, but public schools. I wondered about it, but decided that it must be just a public relations gimmick, something to make the Masonic Lodge system look wholesome, respectable, and safe, along with its similar public policy of giving lip service to patriotism. Next paragraph is, after all, who could find fault with being in support of children and their chance to be educated, to have doors of opportunity open for them as a result of Masonry's consistent ongoing public relation efforts in this regard, the public, when thinking of what Masonry stands for, thinks of the dedicated teacher with an apple on her desk, Old Glory hanging on the walls, God Bless America painted over the door, and a room full of happy, growing children feasting on knowledge. Now, this is an article that I'm not going to read in its entirety because it's not a long article. But see, the Mormons are behind the public schools too. He brings this out in the article, and then he brings out the public education reform movement that hit. They first introduced it in Kentucky. That's why we see the drastic change in public schools curriculum. You know,
it's an easy point, Walt. Sorry to interrupt you. It's an easy point. When you read Rulers of Evil, you know that the Jesuits have pledged themselves to education, or better, indoctrination. And what are they using for this? Learning against learning, as described by F. Tapper Saucy in the book Rulers of Evil. And what does learning against learning stand for? The learning of the scriptures against the learning of worldly affairs.
Yes, that is.
And that's the whole point that you're talking about. You are just explaining what learning against learning means. And, you know, at the time in 1520, Martin Luther already saw the dangers of these. And Martin Luther said in his appeal to ruling classes, quote, "Though our children live in the midst of a Christian world, they faint and perish in misery because they lack the gospel in which we should be training and exercising them all the time. I advise no one to place his child where the scriptures do not reign paramount. Schools will become wide open gates of hell if they do not diligently engrave the holy scriptures on young hearts. Every institution where men are not increasingly occupied with the word of God must become corrupt." End quote. And this is exactly why the Jesuits invented their learning against learning. And when you name this different congregations like the Mormons and, I don't know, did you mention another denomination? I don't know, but for example, the Mormons.
All denominations, really. I mean,
but all denominations, they are all, I mean, churches like the Mormons, churches like the SDA, those were formed by Jesuits themselves.
Nation.
So of course, what you see there is learning against learning, propagation. They will call out for everyone to send their children to public schools because they know there they get indoctrinated with learning against learning, away from the learning of the Bible, learning everything that has nothing to do with God and real life. That's their agenda, and that's how they play it. So I just wanted to intervene with this little comment of mine, but please go on, continue, Walt.
Well, I'm going to just, that's where I was headed. You just touched upon it.
I'm sorry.
I'm glad you did. I mean, in other words, well, we haven't got to the end. When I read this back in 1996, understand, Walt, one of the listeners I talked to in this last week, he says, "You know, Walt, I like listening to you because you're not polished." Yeah, I'm a little rough. I don't have a college education.
You're a diamond in the rough, Walt.
And I don't have a good command of the English language like my brother, York. I have to go to Europe to get tutored. Who do you think edits some of my material? I always have respected anybody who can speak more than one language. Now, he claims he can only speak three, but he can actually speak four. If he dropped down over the border in France, it would only take him a couple of days, and he'd be, you know, you couldn't tell the difference. But the thing of it is, you see, and another thing, this is when I got a computer, and when I started, I've talked to a man in Sri Lanka, I've talked to a man in South Africa, Australia, England, Canada. I've got out of my box. They've kept us Americans in a little box, you see. And we can't see out of that little box. And the reason why we can't see out of that box is they put us in a box in 1776. They took our heritage away. They took our culture away. There was only 2.5 million people in the 13 original colonies, and just a few Catholics. And then Catholics had to walk lightly. Oh, they were very cautious, and they preached religious liberty and tolerance. And their
history. Are you aware of the American Catholic Association? I don't know if that's their true name, but in the documentary I told you about, I was watching now on the SDA, there they talk about that in the United States of America, a special kind of Catholic Church existed in the beginning that didn't pay their allegiance firstly to the Pope, but first and for all to Catholic traditions, so that they could survive in the so-called hostile environment of Protestants over there in America.
Yes, because see, I'm leading to us. That's where I'm going. You see, to understand to our heritage, I often wondered this myself. you know, years ago, I said, what is America's culture? I'll tell you what our culture is. Those 2,500,000 original colonies before 1776 were, they had just came out of persecution. They were over here living on the land in the woods. It wasn't easy to survive. They had to work hard. And a lot of times when the ships came over here for the first winter, half of them would die. It wasn't, but those 2,500,000 knew who the biblical, historical, and prophetic Antichrist, the man of sin, the son of perdition, they knew. And you walk lightly around here. You're not going to build any of your churches. Almost 200 years in England, a new cathedral was never built. And it was the same way in England. It was the same way over here. They would not allow cathedral. In other words, they had to practice in private. They had to work their beads and eat their cookie in private. Why? Because it's a superstitious, idolatrous religion. Do you know why we're in the shape we're in today? Because we have a superstitious, idolatrous religion that's leading us. Joe Biden is a Jesuit. John Boehner, Nancy Pelosi. I could go on and on. They are the ones that are running the show. You know, and so this is where I'm going. I had a friend say this to me, you know, and he said it, and I knew it, he knew it, and York knows it, and you're going to know it when I say it. But 1776 was the American Revolution. Now listen to what I'm saying. I'm going to say it slow. The American Revolution was counter-reformation. It was counter-reformation. Every one of those, and we're going to do a broadcast on this. The last chapter in this book that I didn't write it. I just put the dots in here. But the last chapter I have on the Vatican Jesuit global conspiracy talks about the founders. Now the founders were universalists. They come out of the Enlightenment. I'm not going to stop here and read their quotes, but out of their own words, they were not Christian men. So when we look at the American Revolution and we look at history, you know, I've learned this history. And I say, well, how do you explain this to people? First of all, no one is going to listen to me this far if they haven't been reading their Bible. Because it is written that we're going to have a new world order. It should be no surprise to God's people about what is transpiring here. I mean, I have one of our listeners here, Jesse up by Detroit. He's read the whole climate change encyclical, and he said it was painful. And he, the other a couple days ago, and it was only put out on the 18th, and he'd already read it. And he's reading this encyclical to me, and I said, Jesse, I said, are you reading this right out of the encyclical? He said, yes. Anybody that sees what they're doing with this climate change and this global warming, they are using. And this, look at this man. This man is the man of sin. He's the son of perdition. And he claims to be God. Now, I'm not pointing fingers at him. He claims to be the vicar of Christ. And he's infallible. Now, listen, if Walt came on this broadcast and said, you know, I had something happen to me last week, York. Man, I'm telling you, I woke up in a dream. You know, and I'm infallible. I'm godlike. I mean, I'm a god. That's what the new age is. They want to be gods. See, I'm satisfied with the god. I know where my position is. I'm a man.
Yeah, you are humble and meek, and that's the difference between you and them.
with a flicker of God could wipe me out in a, and he doesn't need a click of the mouse. I mean, he's the one that's running this show. Everything we experience. I don't care where anybody's sitting, and they're sitting in front of a computer, because that's where we're broadcasting from, is a computer. Everything you see has got designs. And see, they don't want to accept it. I had my friend tell me this about Mount St. Helens. I was born and raised in Washington State, and Mount St. Helens went off in 1980. And that was just a burp compared to some of the volcanoes around the world. And they carved out a canyon there. When that mountain moved north, when it blew and literally covered up Spirit Lake. And then it caused a mudslide, and it carved out a canyon in about two or three days. It was a little Grand Canyon. You can go to the Grand Canyon and see the signs of Noah's, of the flood. The flood is looking right, and they tell you on the signs, on the government signs, they say that the Colorado River carved that out in billions of years and millions of years, whatever they want to throw at it. And that Grand Canyon was carved out probably in a 48 hours under the same circumstances that Mount St. Helens, except bigger. Now, why did I go this way? Why am I talking about evolution? Because it is the arm. These our founding fathers came out of the Enlightenment. And their human reason. That's what Freemasonry is. Now I think I've covered this. Now we go back to the statement. So when I talk about John Carroll, Charles Carroll, and another thing I learned this week talking, I've had an opportunity to talk to former Catholics. And I always like to ask the question, when did you learn about the Carrolls? These Catholics that I talked to this last week, former Catholics, they went to Catholic schools. They were never taught about the Carrolls. Now, I'm sure in Maryland and certain places that they do cover them. I mean, you can't blanket this. But they didn't know any more than I know. You see, and I had one young man say to me, he said, in other words, people, it's easy to want to lean on, to hold on that the founders were Christian men, good God-fearing men. No, they weren't. And I said this about George Washington, because George Washington, you know, in some circles is a Christian. In some circles, he's called a Calvinist Baptist. And I said to this young man, and he's sitting in front of a computer. I said to him, I said, well, whether George Washington was a Christian, he was a Roman sympathizer. I said, the first thing he did is made it illegal to practice Guy Fawkes Day here. Because, see, they used to burn the Pope in effigy. Those 2,500,000 people, they had a big party on November 5th. They burnt the Pope in effigy. Why? because of the Inquisition and all the persecution. Why? What built this country? Is the seed built this country? And Roman Catholicism is uprooting the seed. Because why? Because they control education. Now I want to make a point that York brought up. Ed Decker's book, Tom McKinney. The word Jesuit is not in the book. But when you realize that they've used Freemasonry is controlled by the Jesuits. You see, now, these books that talk about Freemasonry, they only take you to a point, and they keep you busy. They keep you going around in a circle like a dog biting his tail, and you never get anywhere. What's taken over this country? Now, I'm not throwing stones. I'm not saying, I'm not trying to advocate a religious war. That isn't the gospel. But Christ has taught us who our adversary is. And one of the books that I have is that I've been printing alongside of the Vatican Jesuit Global Conspiracy is The Antichrist, The Papacy is the Antichrist by J.A. Wiley. And right in his book, page after page after page, and he says it, I don't have it right in front of me, I would read a part of it, but the point of it is to know our adversary. And those 2,500,000 people that were on the colonies prior to 1776 knew who their enemy was. And see, it's always like this. Remember when we were in school? The bully? There's a bully in every crowd. But when he's the minority, he cries and whimpers like a little sissy. And that's what happened in the colonies. They walked very lightly. Yeah, there was Jesuits over here. There was three came over in the Ark and the Dove. And you know, when I say the Ark and the Dove again, I asked the Catholics that I was talking to. Have you ever heard of the Ark of the Dove? No. I'm telling you that it is important. It is important to know the carols. There is no way you can understand the American Revolution if you take the carols out of it. If you take the evidence away, it's like a scene of a crime. And you're getting ready to go to court to defend yourself. And somebody takes all your evidence away from you. You can't show your evidence. That's how important it is to know the real founders of America. The hidden faith of the founding fathers was universalism. The hidden faith of the founding fathers was Romanism. Romanism they had to break and cut off the tie between Protestant England and nowhere. One time I was on a broadcast and I brought this up and I didn't have enough kahuna at the time. I should have stood up. The more you understand, the bolder you get. And this is what I made the statement on this broadcast. There's only been one country, only one country that's ever legislated Romanism out of business. That was Protestant England. The United States of America drafted some Protestant principles, but all the Jesuits wanted was to break that tie. They wanted to get their foot in the door.
So they started a crusade.
So one thing after another, if you look at our history, and you know, and listen, I'm still an American. And that man coming over here, that man of sin, the son of perdition, is not my holy father. And he's not coming over here, as John Boehner would say, in behalf of the American people. He's coming over here in behalf of the goats. They're sheep and goats. And this country is going to reap what it sows. And that's what's happening on September 23rd. September 23rd proves what I just said when my friend said this. The American Revolution was counter-reformation. And you say, well, Walt, how can you say that? Just look at what's happening in 2015. I could go on and on and on. Over 100, I mean, 6 out of 9 chief justices are Catholic. I mean, it is so evident. And you have to, what Bill Cooper said, always said, to understand an event and who's behind it, who benefited from the American Revolution. Who benefited? And to think that on September 23rd, that the son of the man of sin, the son of perdition, is coming to speak, and not only that, the Congress chaplain is a Jesuit. How do I know that the Protestant Reformation is over? Because we haven't heard a peep. You can listen to Alex Jones 3 hours a day, 65 hours a month, and you won't hear the word Romanism, Counter-Reformation, Reformation, Inquisition. They've taken it out of our vocabulary, and they give us Disneyland. Now we live in a magic kingdom, but not God's children. God's children are not deceived. I heard a man say he wants to blame this on the Christians. What we see happening in America. No, no, it's not us Christians that are causing this. It's the goats. It's the goats that are causing this. And you can read that Bible and you can see what's going to happen to America because of it. So anyway, we got another couple minutes to our second part.
That's, I know, yeah.
And that's what I didn't mean, but that I had a lot of things on my mind that I wanted to. And Sammy, my dog, was getting tired of me talking to him. So anyway, I appreciate everybody listening, you know, because that's the truth. That's the truth. And the people that I've been talking to, you know, they know. There's no more speculation. When you come to the hour of truth, it's no more speculation. We understand what's happening in September. How much more time do we have? I don't know. But I'm going to take advantage of today.
Yeah, when the Pope comes over in September, he will start his last crusade against the whole of humanity by starting his environmental encyclical, because that's what it's in the end all about.
That's what it's about. That is exactly. They're going to use that encyclical for civil and religious reasons.
Okay.
Is
come
what
on.
Our listeners, not all of them, we advocate, we want everybody to share this because this is what's happening, but the listeners that come here for some fellowship like-minded. They know what's going on. And all I say to the listeners and the brothers and sisters out here, it is written. Praise God that God has opened our eyes and given us eyes to see and ears to hear.
And we can try to wake up the people with itching ears.
Yes, and maybe we can wake up a few with itching ears. I mean, and it's getting so evident now, and I want to say something else that Jörg mentioned in the first 45 minutes. You can get a little short a version of this, but I want to, if there's any doubting Thomases now, in other words, you know, a lot of people that have been on my site have heard Tom Fresh, and you say, well, you know, Tom gets a little bit overboard sometimes. Doggone, he gets a little overboard. You know, he's telling all, you know, but I'm going to tell you something. If you go to Grand Design Exposed and click at the link at the top that comes to my disclaimer page, the Grand Design Exposed disclaimer, for anybody that wants it to really get a clarity of what's going on, Tom is reading a book by Francis Rooney. He's an insider. He graduated from, he was a Catholic. He graduated from parochial school. He's a graduate of Georgetown University, and he's a Knight of Malta, and he was an ambassador for 3 years. Now, if there's any doubting Thomases, Tom is reading from an insider. I tell you, it's overwhelming. The evidence is so overwhelming, and this book was written, oh, it's been out for 4 years, and now to see what they're doing in September, it's right at the bottom of the page. You'll see I wrote a little paragraph myself because I say this. Alex Jones mentions the elites and the globalists. The book, The Global Vatican, tells us who the elites and globalists work for: the papacy. When you know the history of the Carrolls and you read Francis Rooney, you will realize he knows the history of the Carrolls. Once you understand the Carrolls, now American history makes perfect sense. Yes, he will validate everything that I've ever said about the Carrolls, Francis Rooney.
The reading from Tom of this book is very interesting because I know that he did 6 parts already now because they are uploaded on First Amendment Radio Net YouTube channel as videos, where I just take the MP3 down from and make my own video from. But he was in for more than 5 hours, meaning more than the first 5 broadcasts, only with the introduction of the book. He just started in lecture number 6 about the first chapter. That's how deep Tom goes into the analysis, not only of the book, but of the person and of the circumstances that he's describing in the book, The Global Vatican. So I can really everybody just advise to go there, firstamendmentradio.net, go to Inquisition Update, listen to the live broadcasts. He does them Monday through Friday, I think at 9 o'clock in the morning, his time. You can listen live, or go to the YouTube channel from Nicholas Arthur. And there are the parts uploaded, and you can watch them there. Or you can wait until I bring them out on my YouTube channel. I will probably do that one of these days. And on the second YouTube channel that I have, Jörg's War on Disinfo, I will upload the first, for what I have for the moment, 6 videos all at once, so you can see them there. I mean, get this, more than 5 hours Tom is busy just with the foreword and the explanation what it's all about. Then you can have a little idea of how deep Tom goes into this. This is really some great work that he does there.
And Francis Rooney goes deep. In other words, Francis Rooney is telling it just like it is. Now, it's just like they've taken the veil off. And
yeah, you know, when you listen to this book reading, then you will know firsthand how the dragon talks when listening to this book.
Yes. Yes.
You will really know how the dragon talks.
That's a good analogy. That's a good analogy.
Not only what he says, but how he says it and what he means by this. This whole book that Tom starts reading there, this is why I didn't want to go into that. That book is full with Jesuit casuistry and sophistry.
Absolutely.
And when you are not studied in examining these matters of writing or talking, whatever, then you don't get a clue what that book is all about.
You listen, that's the reason.
And Tom is so literate that he can see that. I mean, it's the same like Richard Bennett did when he analyzed the paper on the Roman Catholic Lutheran Accord that we were discussing in the first few broadcasts on Hour of the Truth. Richard Bennett also has the ability to see through the Jesuitical casuistry and sophistry, and that's really a prime example there. I mean, Tom spending 5 hours just for the introduction, I mean, that says a lot.
Well, when you go to Grand Design Exposed, it was about 3-4 months ago that I spent quite a bit of time on this page. It's called the Grand Design Exposed Disclaimer. In other words, I have a copy of both books. I have a copy of The Ark and the Dove, The Beginning of Civil and Religious Liberties in America, and by J. Moss Ives. And that's what I go into. Warning, beware of Jesuit casuistry and sophistry. I wrote a whole page, and then when you get to the foreword of The Ark and the Dove, I give you examples of the casuistry and sophistry. See, when you know the history, and you know God's word. See, one thing too, this is so important now. They have discredited the word of God so much, but you have, in other words, the more that you see this, the clearer picture you get, the more you see the word of God just come out and jump off the page at you. But I'm glad you brought that up, because see, at the bottom of the page, I give you a little introduction to the Global Vatican book. And matter of fact, if you click on the book, you can find it. I bought mine used. You buy them used, and I got, you know, I was lucky to get one delivered to the door for $7, but you can get them now $9 or $10 delivered to the door. But once you understand Jesuit and casuistry, it is right there in front of you now. We're getting down to the point where I feel a little bit, I don't have to when you got the truth, you don't have to take a second seat to anybody. I don't have to take a second seat to Tex Mars, Alex Jones, Chris Pinto. See, we all have access to and we still have the internet. Now, this internet could be taken away from us in a heartbeat. But the reason why they're not worried about it is because there's so few of us out here. But that doesn't mean that we should just zip our lips and not say anything. We should share this as much as possible, because it gives me comfort. Can you? I see what's going on in education, public schools, and all this stuff, the GMOs, the chemtrails. What if I didn't have God's word? I'd be running around here like a dog chasing his tail.
You'd be lost like a chicken without a hat.
That's right. Have you ever seen it? Yeah,
like most of the people are who start doing their research and always again fall into the same traps. It's the Jews, it's the Zionists, it's the bankers, it's the CFR, it's the Bilderbergers, it's the Trilateral Commission, it's the Club of Rome, it's the Committee of 300, it's the Illuminati, it's the Freemasons. Did I forget anyone?
Oh, you could. There's a, you, there, you,
I, got, I could you, go on for hours and hours. You know, they go from secret society to secret society, or from organization to organization, and they never connect the dots because they do not know the word of God anymore. I didn't either. Little more than 2 years ago, I have never looked at the Bible. I couldn't care less. You know? And that's how most people are today, because of learning against learning.
Learning against learning.
And they take God out of the equation. They take God out of our daily lives, out of our history, and then they put man in our history.
Yes. And I
place man above God. That's their goal. That goes back to the Garden of Eden in Genesis, where the snake told Eve, you can be as gods. That's where it's all
if you do not
know these roots, then you will never understand the tree that is growing in front of you. And that you look at with amaze and amazed because you don't understand how he grows all these leaves. Because you don't look at the root.
And you know, I want to add here that Jörg is reading Rulers of Evil. And he's up into chapter 9 now. And I read that book 4 or 5 years ago. And it's a book that you can't read it the first time. But now with the Pope visiting, when you get into chapters 5, 6, 7, 8, and 9, and you see the machine, how the Jesuit machine is put together, you see exactly what's going on. I mean, in other words, when I read when you think about education, when you see what they get, they're networkers. The Jesuits are networkers. They start an organization here. It's like spinning a top, and they start spinning all these tops. And they can do it because people don't have any, because they've destroyed the Bible. See, when I had a friend, I visited just this last week. I was down, and he was telling me about his neighbors. When you bring the Bible up, when you just mention the word Bible, they just—it's like they just freeze.
And they say that is superstitious and idolatrous.
And well, because they had to destroy God's word with the Bible colleges and the seminaries. It's because it's the oldest history book we got. And there's nothing new. What's going on right today, when you read Jeremiah, there's nothing new. Look what they did to Jeremiah. Is it going to be? It's not any different today. And Christ says in red letters that it's going to be like in the days of Noah. And we're here. But the one thing I want to say is, one I think the people that come and listen, you know, is, yeah, what you're seeing with your own eyes, it's true. The Bible is true. And we need fellowship. We need fellowship. And that is exactly what the reason I come to the mic is. You know, I got a chance to send a book to Japan this last week. I sent a book up to Edmonton, up in Edmonton, Canada. I found another brother I found two brothers here in Oregon. What we lack is fellowship. See, we're not by ourselves. We got God's word. And God said it is written. He said it's written. And we're going to have a world government. I mean, anybody that tries to deny that, and we're going to have a cashless society. I don't know when it's going to happen. It's almost cashless now. But the Bible, it says we're going to have it. And it's not going to be a surprise for us when we wake up some morning we're in a cashless society. But I'm going to tell you, the people that are not walking in God's word, and listening to some of these ministers, see, these ministers are not feeding the sheep. They're not telling them the whole thing, the whole picture. And it's so simple. How do you cover up the Inquisition? They did. They have. They've covered it up. No, the Inquisition happened. It's history. And this new age is just the old age coming back. There's nothing new about this new age. Pantheism, and Paul talks about it in Romans chapter 1. This is nothing new. But I will say one thing. We're living in a time, especially in America, where they've escalated it. I mean, they've thrown us so many, they indoctrinated us. When did they start? 1776. 1776 was when the ecumenical movement started. That's when the Counter-Reformation started. And had they been successful? Well, on September 23rd, you know who's coming. They've been very successful. They've been very successful. And it's a hard pill to swallow. I got this up on my website that I'm doing on reading of Jörg's, when he's reading Tupper Saucy's book. Are you ready to take the red pill? Or you want the blue pill? See? You know, I mean, in the heart, I just talked to a friend this morning on the same thing. When we started waking up to some of this stuff, it hurt. It physically was painful. When you realize just how twisted and how you lacked, you know, there was no way. I'm 71 years old. But I'm not going to spend the rest of the little time that I do have left crying over spilled milk. I'm just so thankful that God has opened my eyes. And so this 4th of July, you know, I'm worried. The only thing I'm worried about is somebody starting a fire.
you're not going to buy any firecrackers or what?
No. And I'll tell you something. I live down here on the Oregon coast where we have a plant called the gorse. It's gorse. Came over here from Scotland in the mid-1800s. And, man, I'm telling you, that stuff is, you throw a match into that stuff and it's just like gasoline. So, you know, I'm living one day at a time, and I realized that I could be hitting the trail. This town that I lived in burnt down in 1936 because of gorse. So, but you know, I maybe got a little bit of, I don't call it anxiety, but I thoroughly now appreciate every day. See, we don't have time to argue and debate. Those days are gone. Those days are gone. I mean, we got 3 months until the dragon comes over here.
Then
three
firm
months.
In the truth, and the truth shall make you free.
That's right. That's right. You know. So anyway, we might get started on the book, but
yeah, that's all right.
And also too, I want to just make this out. You send me an email and contact me and give me a name and an address, and I'll send you a customized book printed right out of the bunker, the information terrorist bunker on the south coast of Oregon. It's hand printed. It's printed on my printer, on a laser printer, and I even put the binder on it. So it's a It's crafted. It's crafted, handcrafted. So anyway, I'm ready to get into the book when you are.
Okay, I will start reading on page 27 on the global Vatican Jesuit global conspiracy from Dr. Cook from 1985 on the top of page 27. The Vatican has kept the people in Central America in ignorance and misery for centuries. It is in the interest of the Vatican to keep its stranglehold on these nations. They are doing so either by the death squads in El Salvador or the Jesuit Marxists in Nicaragua, but they are maintaining their hold over the people. The U.S., as a Protestant country, could bring some pressure to bear, which could really liberate the people from both warring factions. But alas, no such pressure is ever brought to bear on the Vatican. Instead, the United States seems to become more and more the lackey of the Vatican, and the power that keeps the rotten status quo in place in Latin America. A classic example of their failure to uphold the one truly free government in Central America was seen in the case of Rios Montt in Guatemala. Rios Montt was a charismatic Protestant. He had his limitations, to be sure, but he was beginning to bring some real liberty to the people of Guatemala. As far as we can ascertain, the Roman Catholic Church began to agitate for his removal. We only picked up small items of news here and there, but we did read that some leaders in Guatemala were concerned that unless he was removed, he was going to cause a civil war in Guatemala. One item also spoke of the fact that anti-Catholic feeling was being generated by his fanatical form of Christianity. All this is the same old Jesuit line we are seeing in Canada and the U.S. today. That is, no one should say anything against the Pope or Roman Catholicism. As we are typing these pages, we read that several people have been arrested in Canada for distributing anti-Catholic literature. Imagine, if you can, getting arrested in a so-called free country for passing out literature of a theological nature. Truly, the freedoms of the Protestant Reformation are being seriously abridged right now in North America. Montt was deposed, and the Vatican returned to power in Guatemala with the tacit approval of the CIA, or Catholics in Action, Protestant Americans, Better Wake Up. The Vatican is the center of a never-ending web of conspiracy. It is working day and night to bring the world to the feet of the Roman Pontiff. The Vatican octopus has tentacles reaching into almost every government circle on the earth. When the Red Chinese needed the offshore oil drilling expertise of the United States, no other country possesses it, a bargain was struck so that the Jesuits were once again allowed into China. Surely such a move is almost incredible when viewed in the light of the fact that America is still an overwhelmingly Protestant nation, at least in the numerical makeup of their population. Well, I just have to insert here that all the so-called Protestant denominations over there in the United States of America, in the meantime, by helping of Vatican II, the ecumenical movement, have been infiltrated by the Jesuits. And therefore, these Protestants listen to the same king than the Catholics do, the king of Rome, the son of perdition, the man of sin, the Antichrist, or the mouth of Satan. The Vatican works.
One comment here.
Yeah, okay.
Is one of the reasons that attracted me to this little pamphlet is because it was written in 1985. You know, and I'm sure Ronald Cook today in 2015 would be writing this in a little different perspective. But in other words, he was so right on, and so many of his points that I was compelled to put some more dots with it. So that's what I have to say and give credit to Ronald Cook.
Mm-hmm. Okay. The Vatican works incessantly at building bridges. Ah, and who is the supreme bridge builder? Pontifex Maximus. The Vatican works incessantly at building bridges over which its plans may be put into operation. Pedro Arupe then the head of the Jesuits, the Black Pope, was the man that Pope Paul VI sent to Moscow in 1971. He met with the communists to try to get the then repressive government of Czechoslovakia to relax her repressive policies. When he returned from Moscow, he stated that he saw signs of relaxation of religious persecution in Russia. Billy Graham came back with the same line. Arupe was immediately challenged by the director of Lithuanian Catholic Aid, Kazimir Pugevičius, who said that Arupe's statement was, quote, a time-serving Soviet maneuver used in order to create a false impression, unquote. It is obvious that the Vatican wants a soft line taken toward communist Russia because the ultimate goal of the one world church envisaged by the Vatican is the total absorption of all into one true fold of Romanism. Bible Protestantism is the only faith that can never capitulate to Romanism. Romanism, with its ability to absorb false religions into its fold, will become the cage of every unclean bird. But it can never absorb Bible Protestantism, because the difference between the two is of such a nature that union is spiritually and ecclesiastically impossible. This is the reason biblically ignorant newsmen speak of the bigotry of the Bible-believing fundamentalists of our times. They do not realize that the eternal difference that exists between vital biblical Christianity on the one hand and all false religions on the other. So Bible Protestantism must ultimately be the target of every conspiracy and the target of the final apostate conglomerate. And this continues reading The Jesuits Today, Chapter 2 of the book of the Vatican Jesuit Global Conspiracy, by Dr. Ronald Cook from 1985. And before we go into the next chapter that is called The Financial Empire Second to None, Walt has some remarks to make. Please, Walt.
Yeah. Well, it ends with, so Bible Protestantism must ultimately be the target of every conspiracy and the target of the final apostate conglomerate. This is why we are seeing history. We are seeing prophecy fulfilled right before our eyes. It's because how can, you know, when one thing in 1776, you know, they came to agreement that they didn't want to take orders from a king or a pope. That was the idea of separation of church and state. But look what's happening. Look what's happening in 2015. See, we're talking about something that's going to happen in 3 months. And I can tell you what it's going to be. We've already did a broadcast. He's going to speak to Congress on the 23rd, and then he's going to the UN on the 25th. And they're going to be pushing global warming in the Pope's encyclical on climate change. This is real. And the thing about it is, I've learned this from a friend. I understand the liberal mind. You see, people that have been pushing this global warming, and it's just nothing but a fraud. Scientists have proved it. I mean, I don't have time to go into that part of it.
Well, that would be interesting, Walt.
Well, but there's plenty of that up on the internet that you can understand. But in other words, I mean more
in the sense like we have been talking about. I don't know if it was in an earlier broadcast or if it was just in a chat between us two that I told you. When I went to school in the 1970s, they told us there was an ice age coming.
Yeah, that's right. Go ahead.
And now we're about a little 40 years later, and now it is not an ice age, now it is global warming. The problem is to substantiate their alleged ice age, they took studies over millions and millions of years of the development of the Earth and the weather here on the Earth. And they do the same stuff now with global warming. They are talking about millions and millions of years because, you know, the Earth is 5 billion years old or something like that. And the climate changes over millions and millions of years. But within 40 years, everybody has to wake up now. Whoever has been to school and has been taught that, wake up, people. They told you 40 years ago that we are drifting into another ice age. And now, since a few years already, they tell you that we are drifting into global warming, melting ice caps. How did that change all in 30 years when all the rest of the climate change they use is for millions and millions of years? How can that even be? You know? This is an interesting point I'd like to bring up once for people to think about. I mean, a lot of the people who are listening to this broadcast right now and probably later on when we have the video have an age that they remember that they in school were told there is coming an ice age. And now just 30 years, 35 years later, they change it. No, it's not an ice age, it's global warming all of a sudden. So all the people who have been studying all that stuff in the 70s, 60s, when they went with that agenda, all these people were probably dumb and uneducated because they couldn't read the charts, the charts of the worldwide weather during the last million years. Of course they couldn't read that because there's not a history of a few million years. But anyway, they are making these people now looking dumb, but that doesn't matter because we are already in a new generation. Most of the people who heard that when they were young don't remember that they heard that when they were young. They believed it then as they believe global warming right now. And they tell us that man is responsible for global warming because of CO2. That is what we exhale. That means when they get rid of you, they get rid of your exhaling CO2, and that means there is no global warming. Isn't that a nice agenda to implement the 500 million of the Georgia Guidestones, where we are now with 7.1 billion or something like this on the Earth, and we have to lose about 95% of these? And you can be very sure about that. You can bet on it. You are not one of the ones they want to survive. They're going to breed themselves an own class of citizens when they are done with us. That's their plans. And there is nothing you can do about it. There's only one thing, and that is invite Jesus Christ into your life. Let the truth into your life, and all these things, all these agenda, you couldn't care less. Because you know what's coming, and you know who's your savior, and you know who's your friend, and you know who to turn to. And that's the big difference between us fundamentalist Protestants here on this broadcast and most of the other people out there, because they have no idea. They are waiting for a rapture, which is even not a word in another language than Latin. Rapture is a Latin word. It's nowhere to be found in the Bible. And the Bible doesn't speak of a rapture. The Bible speaks of a resurrection and an instantaneous change at the time of Jesus' coming.
And that's
come on,
why,
Bob, there's something you want to say, I guess. Yeah?
Well, and that's the reason why I think the thing, especially the people that are on this call, are people that are well-researched and know some of this. They know this. But what this is for us to regurgitate some of this and realize why this is coming about. It's coming about because they're not reading their Bible.
No. When they implement all this climate change agenda on us, they implement evolution on us, and they implement New Age theosophy on us.
And what I said earlier in the first part of the broadcast, they've misdirected God's by taking control of the seminaries and the Bible colleges.
Of misdirection, huh?
And we're going to get into this book, and there's a chapter in here about the conspiracy of misdirection. But they did it all with futurism. You see, I have that up in one of my books. It's the origin of dispensational futurism. In other words, they did it simply like this. It's real simple. All the reformers, you know, sometimes people get mixed up on what futurism is. Futurism is a futurism that every single Bible college and seminary are teaching that the Antichrist is to come out into the future, the last 7 years.
One single person.
You see, in the biblical historical man of sin, son of perdition, is the papacy in succession. The Antichrist is alive and well today. And when ministers, and you see it, anytime you hear a minister talk and talk and talk and talk and never tell you who our real adversary is, our adversary is Romanism. Daniel told us that Rome would be in power. This can be the last power before Christ returns. And they did it with Ribera in about, I forget what year it was, I forget what.
1585, and he died in 1591.
Yes. In other words, and it started slow, you see, but I've got the history in one of my books. I've got that history of that in the book, The Papacy is the Antichrist by J.A. Wiley. I put it in the back of the book, so you can go up to my website right now and get that PDF file. And it tells you the history. In other words, this didn't happen overnight. Because you see, every single reformer, every single one, you know, all men like Charles Spurgeon, you know, and George Whitfield, and all the reformers, Calvin, every one of them, it was the papacy. That's what built goes back to our seed. Those 2,500,000 original 13 colonies. That's the Christian founding of America. It isn't what we got in 1776. That was the Counter-Reformation. The American Revolution was the Counter-Reformation. And let me emphasize this again. Every single seminary and Bible college, if you're listening to a minister that's came out of one of these, he's teaching futurism. He is not telling you who the adversary is, who our enemy is. If he did, there would be an outcry. You wouldn't see the man of sin, the son of perdition, coming on September 23rd. That's what this last paragraph in this. How did they do it? They did it by taking over the seminaries and Bible colleges.
And the schools, Walt.
And they did that through the Freemasons. The Freemasons, if you listen to the first part of the broadcast when I brought it up. The public school connection is the Freemasons run the public schools. And that's why when that school bus goes by in the morning and when I see that bus stop out here, it gives me chills. And when I see the parking lots filled up in town on Sunday, and I know that they have a minister up there that's teaching them, they're not teaching them the Bible. They're not teaching them. Listen, God told us who our adversary was, not Walt Stickel, not John Calvin. But
well, we can put it this way, Walt. God made very clear in the Bible, in the Old Testament, who Jesus Christ was. when he comes, what he will do, what he will say, so that everybody who lived at that time had the opportunity to wake up to the ministry of Jesus Christ. And God left, did not use any less of his power to let us understand who the Antichrist is. He wanted us to know who his son is, who the Christ is, who our Savior is, and he also made it very clear within his book who the Antichrist is. The problem is that people are always, how can I say that best, not to offend anyone, but most of the times people are too lazy to even get into books and read. This is not of our time anymore, you know. We live in the time of the internet. We live in the time of YouTube. It's only videos, 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 videos. And I can speak for myself. Man, I've been watching more than 10,000 videos since the time I've woken up a little 5 years ago from here. I watched thousands and thousands and thousands of videos. But I also did my research on documents backing these videos up. And by going into the documents, I came here and there against books that were probably interesting. And so I have a digital library of more than 150 books, I think, on my computer, which I didn't read them all, absolutely not, but read a little bit here and read a little bit there to gain understanding. But therefore, you really have to study. And the system that the Jesuits set up for us, the Jesuitical theater, as it is also called, is only there to distract us, from the things that are important in our life, for our understanding of life, and for our future. And that's what they know, and that's why they did it the way they did it, because they know people. They took over the whole psychology movement. And that started with people like Friedrich Hegel in Germany. You know, the one with the Hegelian dialectic? That's how they got the Germans off of Protestantism in that time. And that's how they get everybody today away from studying significant things. Just give them an iPhone where they have 24 hours access to the internet, to the television, to all Hollywood movies, to all Hollywood series. Just keep them busy. Bread and games. First of all, games. Second of all, bread. And afterwards, of course, you will never bite the hand that feeds you. And that's what they're leaning on. And that's why they are so successful today. And they have been so successful the last 500 years.
1 minute.
You have something for a closing statement, Walt?
No, I just thank for the people that that you know send me emails and that I've had a chance to send books to. That anybody that's like I said that sends me an address, I'll send them a book, and I love to sit down and publish a book. And thank God that God showed an old man of 71 years old how to publish a book, you know. And anyway,
yeah, you may be old, but you're not dumb, huh?
Well, I'm you know, let's put it this way. You younger men have more powder than I do, but I've still got some powder. So anyway, with that, I'm going to sign off.
You still got some powder, yeah.
So God bless, and we'll
okay,
see you next, and see you next week.
Yeah. Thank you very much for your contribution, and thank you very much for our listeners here in the chat room and the viewers of the video later on. Until next week, thank you for watching, thank you for listening. God bless you, and bye-bye.